Hey guys, today we're going to talk about the 350Z's no lift design. Today I'm doing an oil change on the Zed, and I figure while I have the car in the air, I might as well put the shrouds back in and kind of go over Nissan's no lift design. When you look underneath the car in the wheel wells, for example, there are lots of vents for air to flow through. Now, compared to a regular car, let's say like this 93 Camry, when you look inside, it's just a shield. It just prevents water from entering key areas in the engine bay. While on these cars, they actually allow air to flow through in certain areas. A few years ago, I was trying an HR-style Y-pipe, and we had to remove these shrouds. Now, we're going to go look underneath the car and show you what's underneath these things. So looking underneath the car, you can see on the driver's side, there's nothing there. We've removed it, and you see it's just the floorboard. Now, here is the shroud installed. So the whole thing that Nissan is trying to do is they were trying to make the floor underneath the vehicle as flat as possible. This would allow for better airflow and create that no lift effect. So you can see there's a reason why the factory exhaust is tucked up high the way it is. So if you were to remove these and you were going with an aftermarket style exhaust that does not follow the same route as the factory, in theory you would lose stability at high speeds. Now I have to admit, this no lift design is probably only effective at, you know, close to 130 miles 150 miles an hour. If you're doing 60 miles per hour on the highway, you're probably never going to really notice the advantages of having these pieces. But Nissan did spend a lot of time engineering this car, and it's cool that they went this far underneath. So here's a closer look underneath the vehicle. You see there's nothing to protect. So if I used to think, I wasn't sure what it was, I'm like, why is there a splash shield under here? And you think there'd be some sort of electronic device that they're trying to protect from water, but underneath there's absolutely nothing. So it's safe to say that this is just strictly for aero. So we got our pieces back in, looks nice and factory. I mean, I really didn't like not having these, but with the other Y-pipe, we just had to, because the collector came all the way down here. So with the Motordyne XYZ pipe, you notice that it has all the clearance that you need. So this is the Y-pipe that I would definitely recommend if you guys are trying to upgrade parts. Like, if you like to have the ability to change out the midsection with a cat, straight pipe, resonator, this is a very flexible Y-pipe. I just want to thank Charlie at Full Throttle for selling me these parts on eBay. It just happened by coincidence. I was purchasing from him and he recognized my username and he was able to sell me both sides, which is pretty awesome. So thanks a lot again, man. So you guys can see with my factory style exhaust, it's tucked up quite high. This will prevent having drag at higher speeds. Now there are some dual exhaust systems that on the other side, the pipe has to go underneath. I'm sure it doesn't affect the car that much, but there's a reason why Nissan never did it in the first place. Now this is an aftermarket muffler, but I did notice on the factory muffler there was a bit of a triangle here and I couldn't figure out why. So it was supposed to act kind of like a little spoiler and create downforce off of this, or it was to help attribute to that flat floor design to help air sleek through the back of the car. So that part I'm not sure what the purpose of the triangle is. I'm going to go with it's supposed to be part of the flat floor. Underneath the front of the vehicle, you can see that it's completely covered, and then there's a little access point here for your drain plug. I recommend if you're ever doing an oil change, remove these two 10 mils, remove it over here, push it down, use a funnel, because the oil, it just spurts out and just gets all over the place. That's the way to do a tidier oil change. But you notice over here, there's bracing, and in between the bracing, they add another piece of plastic for a shroud. So this, yes, will act like it's a huge splash shield. Most cars have this. Back here, they totally didn't need to put this piece of plastic in, but I'm sure it's just to help that air flow underneath the vehicle. Now, unfortunately, they didn't put anything underneath the transmission, probably due to heat, serviceability, and cost. It just wasn't advantageous for them, but it would help if that were covered too, I'm sure. Because if you look at most supercars, you can't even see any of the drivetrain. Most supercars are completely flat because they do go quite fast. This car, on a perfect day and the right conditions on a big track, can probably get close to 150 miles an hour. Most people are not taking this car that fast. So I can see why they didn't do it there. But if you look here from the car, we get the camera nice and up high. You can see how it's relatively flat looking at it and everything's really tucked up nicely. Here's a point of reference for everything that we've been talking about. So I decided to just
Google search 350Z no lift design. I've also come across a documentation on this from Best Motoring. They have a couple of videos where they really talk about the 350 when it first came out, and they go over quite a few design aspects, and no lift comes up. So this is from How Stuff Works, and it's from the editors of Consumer Guide. I've read Consumer Guide quite a bit when I was a teenager, when I would buy used cars, because, well, the internet wasn't nearly as developed as it is now today. So it talks about how Nissan and their technical engineers went through a lot of testing with aerodynamics. Pretty much every vehicle goes through this. And they wanted to make a vehicle that was a lot more stable at high speeds. If you were to look at, here's a picture from one of my videos. If you were to look at the 350 bone stock, some of them, I've added a rear spoiler over here, but some of them from factory do have a small spoiler, but they never come with a giant one in the back. So looking at the design of the car, there's really no big wing to add stability at high speed, because there are functional wings you can put on, but that would add drag, and I guess it just doesn't go with the look of the car at all. So the way for them to achieve high speed stability was to go for primarily to attain a zero body lift. So increased stability would be benefit with lower road noise as well as a side effect. So what they're trying to do is manage airflow under the vehicle. The tendency of the body to lift during high-speed driving was eliminated, and the car felt as if they were driving in a vacuum. The precise handling experience at low speeds could also be enjoyed at high speeds. And there were little things that they did to achieve this. So they say the 350's floor was designed to be as flat as possible, with a few pieces protruding and creating drag. The exhaust system was routed to hug the underbody, with cross-flow muffler laid out flat. That's why I, as you saw earlier, I was big on keeping a stock exhaust layout, because there's a reason why they tucked it up. And then they talk about how the fuel tank was tucked up under the floor beneath the luggage area. Front bumper and engine under cover were shaped to help compress the air and increase its velocity, thus decreasing the pressure and creating a vacuum under the car, sucking it to the ground. So I found those things were all very interesting. And it goes into more detail of things that they added to the vehicle. And then they talk about its drag coefficient. So the regular 350 is at 0.30. And then if you had the track model, it had a little more aero on it. So it hit 0.29. And then you can see car and driver, they also reinforce that. If you look down, they do talk about its coefficient here. I had it saved here for you guys. Anyways, if you go in the car and driver, here it is. So top line track line model tested here with the front and rear spoilers, eliminating front and rear lifters. I think they're talking about the outside of the vehicle though on the top. So it went from 0.3 to 0.29. So that is also the same information. And then looking over here, we talked earlier about how some higher end supercars or sports cars, they'll have under trays as listed over here. So the underside of the vehicle often traps air in various places and adds turbulence around the vehicle. This is from Wikipedia. In most racing vehicles, this is eliminated by covering the entire underside of the vehicle. That is called an undertray. So the 350 does not do that, but it tries to take certain elements. So areas where it would have the most issues, they have put plastic bits to eliminate that. So let's just look at this picture over here. This is underneath a 350. You can see here the engine cover shroud has been removed. And then we talked about this piece connecting the two, keeping it more smooth. This area around the transmission's all open. And then those two side pieces in the middle that we reinstalled, that helps keep the floor low, because I guess there's some bracing here where it transitions. I forgot to mention this part. So there's some more plastic parts there too, to help it transition, I guess, away from the suspension, because there's a lot of parts on the rear suspension that would create drag. And we did talk about the stock muffler. So if you look at this area, sorry, I'm a horrible drawer with a mouse. You can see that it comes quite forward. So I guess that helps the airflow transition here, keeping it nice and flat. So I found that interesting. I also found interesting how they lifted the vehicle for this picture. Even in the manual, they say to go in the pinch seam, but they put in the same part that I like too. I guess thick steel is thick steel in these vehicles. So hopefully, guys, you learned something new and understand a little bit more why Nissan puts these parts into the vehicle. Like, there is a reason for everything and why they design things and why they put pieces there. So if you're going to change out parts and you're going to either modify or remove other parts,
try to understand what you're removing and what its original purpose was before you go too far. Those, like I said, those little shrouds back there, those little shields, I did remove them. Drove on the highway, you don't notice them. But if you're doing track driving at really high speed, you might. I might as well show this because I know someone's going to complain that I put the jack stands right here. I noticed a lot of previous owners of S14s or 240s, they complained that they dented up this area whenever they would put the axle stands there. Well, this isn't a 240. If you like today's content, make sure to check out my channel and hit the subscribe button and make sure to hit that bell notification. What that does is it makes sure that you're always kept up to date with all the content that we're providing with you guys on YouTube. So the way that we have the channel set up is I have the uploads up top. That way at all times you can always see, if you just hop by the channel, what our latest upload is. Plus with the bell notification, you're going to get some sort of message from YouTube itself. We also have popular uploads, car videos, how-to videos, demonstration and informational videos, and a lot of cool other specific car videos like our builds playlist. I really like the builds playlist because it takes all the theories from our how-to section and it keeps applying it to different vehicles.